Hey there, folks. Ford here. We are going to be doing another vintage cube, but we're going to be doing the other version that I mentioned, the single elimination version. So this is the one that I was talking about where you play against strictly the other seven players that you draft with, and therefore you kind of need to worry about what's being drafted a little bit more because the table is locked in, you know? You're not going to be seeing cards that you draft played against you, as some people might be used to. I was very used to this way of playing, but we used to do it round-robin version, and you would get to play all three rounds. You had options. And this is the option to do it now, but it's single elimination. So the prizes are a little bit higher, because the risk is a little bit higher. We're going to be in this draft here. See, I'm the fourth one in. We are waiting to play. This queue doesn't fill nearly as quickly as the leagues do. For many reasons. Because this is just such a big risk compared to the other one. It's not a guaranteed three matches, so you don't really seem to get your money's worth unless you feel like, you know, you're very good at this type of magic. I don't feel like I'm a master of the Vintage Cube, but the Vintage Cube is my favorite way to play magic if I do play it online. So I'm pretty well vetted. The only problem is that I'm used to a lot of other cards being in the cubes because I've played this cube for so many years. They've changed it so many times with so many different things over the years. You know, new cards come out and old ones get pulled out of the cube and the new ones get stuffed in. So it's difficult to get used to that kind of stuff. Things, combos that I'm used to and, archetypes. Some archetypes have just been falling to the wayside because certain cards get pulled out, and some years and, times, they'll pull out, six, seven cards of a certain archetype, and it'll just kind of be gone. And it's not for any certain reason. It's so that they can create two other archetypes instead or something like that. So, it's not that I'm against it. It's just something to get used to. It's change. So we got six people in the draft now. Waiting for two more. All right, now we are firing up this here draft. I love the sound of the opening of the pack, but no cards. Okay, so I didn't really announce any kind of plan. I was thinking about doing like a mono green ramp into like a Banefire or Bonfire of the Damned or something like that, or do like a white weenie deck. But it seems like, of course I'm going to take this power here. This is obviously the card to pick. It's a free forest artifact. Sneak Attack is an amazing archetype to go with. This is a great card for Storm. Chase the Mind Sculptor. It's really down to those two. If you really want to talk about which card to pick in the first pick, it's those two, Jace or Mox Emerald. Mox Emerald's my pick. Well, if you want to go with the mono green ramp, you get the guy that defines the mono green ramp deck. Rathalos is the guy. So, I don't think this will come back on the on the way around. This is something I'm certainly looking for to come back. Otherwise, I don't really care. Maybe this. So there are several cards I'd like to see come back, but the ones that I think are, you know, that I'm paying attention to probably aren't going to come back. But if they do, that's a great surprise. So if we're going still with the mono green or green red or green some other color, Raphaelos is the guy. A lot of good storm cards here. High Tide is pretty amazing. Dark Ritual is very good. Bitter Blossom is always good. Eureka is kind of a trap sometimes, in my opinion. I feel like Smuggler's Copter could be the pick here. This is something that can steal some games. You know, your opponents may not get any flying creatures, and you just have a bunch of little 1-1s, and you just tap it whenever you play a new 1-1 and equip it, or what is it, crew it, and you know, you've got a 3-3 flying creature that draws you more cards. So it's pretty difficult to fight that. I'm going to go with the Copter. Wow, got some pretty good stuff for my deck. I like the new Jade Light Ranger. That guy's in standard right now, I believe. One of the Ixalan sets. Ixalan. Double Explore. Ooh, it's pretty good. This guy is amazing. I mean, come on. You can't. The Rage Hermit is untouchable, pretty much. So, if you want to go with green white, you know, I might want to go with Mirari's Wake. If you want to really ramp up hard, you can get Mirari's Wake and you can get a bunch of dorks and, you know, go that way. I'm thinking Deranged Hermit could be the play. Genesis Wave is definitely one of those cards that will be one of the last cards to be picked. So this is a reason why I mentioned the green-red deck. That goes into Banefire or some kind of X burn spell. This is something that, if you have a bunch of dorks, like I was talking about, a bunch of mana dorks, you can just get so much, you know, mana just from that, and then tap the dorks themselves, and then whatever land you have, and have a gigantic Banefire on your hands. Always like that. So if we're gonna start spreading into red, we can start looking at some spot removal like Mizzium Mortars. Probably don't want anything that spreads damage to every creature, especially if we're going to have a lot of creatures ourselves. Skull Clamp is a good one. Now, I don't exactly have any 1-1s, a lot of 1-1s right now other than this. Skull Clamp will work terrifically with that. Riskar, something that's always good, but it's always dealt with pretty handily. So, I like Skull Clamp here for future picks. I mean, you know, that seems to be my default pick. If I see that in a pack, I'm going to go for something similar to this, something that taps for mana. This is a fantastic card, but it's something that I'm not going to see for a lot, you know, a long time in a game. So, I like Wind War Elves. Man, this could be difficult here. Vraska the Seeker. We got Mindslaver. We got a Sword of Feast and Famine. This is difficult because there really isn't, you know, a plan A card to take. This is okay. I like Nykthos here. I also like the turn one, you know, creature, so I didn't see that initially. So I'm gonna go with that. Oh, the Reclamation Sage came back. Yes. I hesitate to take Eureka, but it is in my color, so it'll, you know, kinda have me call green for me. I'll take Genesis Wave at this point. Sideboard both of them right now. So we got two mana producing one drop creatures. Skull Clamp can't kill Tree Speaker unless you don't level it up. Wow, Rishkar came all the way back around. Okay. Not the worst thing in the world. So far, a mono green aggro deck with Xenagos possibly in the deck. Wow, open Mox Sapphire. I mean, it's difficult not to take that. Lotus Cobra, I mean, and Beast Within are two cards for sure, but I mean, Grim Monolith is always good to take, but Mox Sapphire, you really don't want anyone else to have power. This is a very powerful card, but this is part of the Power 9, you know, so I mean, you know, this is three mana once, and then you really have to go out of your way to get it again, unless you have some kind of engine. So, you know, I feel like Mox Sapphire is the pick. Man, that's a good one. If you're getting a lot of ramp, I mean, that's one of the best cards in the whole cube. This is, I mean, seriously, you exile two permanents when it comes into play, when you cast it, not when it comes into play, you have to cast it. 10-10 indestructible, and then when it attacks, they have to exile 20 top 20 cards of their library. And it doesn't even target the defending. It just says defending player exiles the top 10 20. So if you have, say, you know, Leyline of Sanctity out, you don't have protection from it. That is pretty insane. So we're going to go with that. You know, if we're going to get a bunch of ramp like that, we already have Rishkar. We got Rathalos, obviously, like I was talking about. We have the two mana-producing elves right here and two Moxes so far. I'm pretty sure we can get Ulamog out. Maybe not, you know, by turn 4 or 5 where it's really crucial. But, you know, we'll see what happens. Maybe we'll get real lucky and get a Black Lotus on the third pack. Let's see here. I like Terastodon. Ancient Stirrings, I mean, I don't really have too many colorless cards that I care about. I mean, Ulamog, actually, it does say colorless, right? So, it doesn't mean it's an artifact. Yeah, okay. Well, it did get considerably better when it says colorless. I forget about that. Terastodon, geez, you just play that and destroy three of your lands. If you play it early enough, you destroy three of your own lands, and it's just almost unbeatable. Take the Age of Stirrings. I don't normally use that in cube, but see what happens. Courser of Krufix. Now, the Oracle of Moldiah is really what you're looking for in this kind of ramp deck, you know? Because Courser does not allow you to play an additional land. That's the only issue with that. Garrick Primal Hunter, I mean, the only reason I'm going to take this is because it's in my color. There's really no other card in this whole pack for, you know, for the deck that I want to do. Anyway, so you got the original Garrick here. I mean, always good. Don't have a lot of creatures to do the overrun with. But the Green Sun Zenith is just far and away the winner. You know, a dual land is something I look at, especially late in this, you know, so late in, you know, packs like this. Mobile Roots is always good to pick. I don't know. That's ramp in and of itself. I don't have anything white anyway, so. Ooh, there's the Crater of Behemoth. Jeez. That's late. Take this Beast Within, too. And this Acidic Slime. Oh, I might take this Trigon Predator, actually. You could play it through the Mox Sapphire. Excuse me, y'all. Coughing a little bit. Yeah, another drawback to these drafts here is between the matches, you have to wait for, you know, whatever other matches there are going on to finish. Granted, you know, in the first round, there are only three other matches, of course. So, you know, if you're the first one finished and you finish in 5 minutes, you know, you got to wait maybe 45 minutes, upwards of 45 minutes to, you know, have everyone else finish. So that's one really annoying part of it that it used to be. You used to have to sit here and wait around forever. That's another huge reason everyone joins the leagues. It's all at your own leisure. You can do the draft, and then you can just play them, you know, match by match, however you want. So Shardless Agent's the only card that's, you know, halfway in our color. I've already picked the Predator. I'm gonna pull the Agent. Probably gonna pull the Predator for now too. And I might just pull the Xenagos because I'm not seeing any other red that I want to play. Now these cards are not, you know, pulled out of the main deck, you know, permanently by any means. So to get, you know, a pretty good contingency of blue-green cards. One of my favorite cards back in the day, Apocalypse. Great art. Love that kind of stuff. These new arts are, you know, I mean, I'm okay with them. I just kind of confused as to why they can't use the old arts. But I'm sure there's a good reason. I don't know it, though. A Hulk Blossoms in the end. Okay, what are we going to get? A third piece of power. Wow. I mean, yeah, like the elf is great and all, and, you know, the elf queen seems cool. But, I mean, I got to take Mox Pearl. What is wrong with me if I don't take Mox Pearl? So in an 8-person draft, 24 packs, I have gotten 3 of the 9 pieces of power. That's kind of absurd. And I really didn't need them. I mean, the green one, of course, is great. That's kind of what steered us toward getting this mono green deck, but very confusing. I mean, the numbers, the possibility of getting all three of those in the opening packs are pretty low, I would think. The probability. Couldn't think of the word. The probability. Mana Crypt is pretty strong. Jeez. Getting lots and lots and lots of mana for free. I do kind of want to take this, though. I didn't see that at the very right before I took that artifact. I saw that this Master of the Wild Hunt is very good, and it is a mythic, and it would fit perfectly in my curve. I just feel like it might come back around. I'm gonna take the Finhorn Elves. It goes so much better with Crater Hoof, and it's, you know, it's just very straight up, straightforward. I'm gonna cut this Wall of Blossoms for right now. Let's see. Hopefully we get some more little dorks like that. Oh, perfect. Just like that. This is great. Hopefully this comes back around. This is something I certainly would love to see. If I'm going to go with the Xenagos. I would like to see Banefire. That's something that would be, you know, kind of sought after right now. Got Karn Liberated. That's the original Karn that Tron uses in Modern. I mean, you know, I'm tempted to take the Song of the Dryads, but, you know, I don't really have any other win conditions than combat right now, and this could possibly be it. Or at least create, you know, another win condition for me. I don't know. I like it. I mean, this 1-1, you know, I like it too. Bloodbraid is always solid. I didn't have the Mux Ruby. I got Pearl and Sapphire along with the Emerald. So I was thinking maybe Bloodbraid Elf. Don't really have anything to go in there fit with it. Just gonna get with the Elder here. Oh man, got another dork. Got another dork. Ooh, I got distracted there, sorry. I mean, Natural Order's probably the pick, but, you know, Skullclamp with Awakening Zone is really good, too. And I didn't get Progenitus. So that's probably a big reason for me not to take Natural Order. I don't know why everybody passes this card up. This card mills, you know, a quarter of your opponent's deck. Now, I do gain 7 life with this. I didn't get Eternal Witness, so I can't really go nuts with it. I like the sword. I got a lot of creatures. We can handle it. Got the Planeswalker to come back around. Okay, that's very good. Master of the Wild Hunt came back around, like I thought. Wow, Dragonlord Atarka came back around. I was not expecting that to come back. Okay. Song of the Dryads came back around too. Okay, got some removal that way. I'm taking Bloodbraid, just because. Got 3 good red-green cards. Got 1 really good green-blue card. Probably will still play the Trigon Predator because I did get Mox Sapphire. I didn't get really a way to produce red. Like, I didn't get Birds of Paradise or Sylvian Caryatid or anything like that. See, I'm looking through the deck right now. Yeah. I don't have really any way to create red mana. So, we're just going to have to wing it here. That's Scavenging Ooze to back it up. And Goblin Chain Whirler, the standard standout these days. Ooh, boy. He is pretty intimidating, I'll tell you that. That is a bunch of chains. Okay. So we ended up getting a considerable amount of dorks and, you know, mana producers. However, I don't think Ancient Stirrings is going to stick. I mean, I do have, let's see, I got 2 win conditions through it. And I do have, well, I don't know, I might keep it actually. Let's see if we can do it here. Because we got 32 playable cards. We can reduce it down to 29, I guess, with the Mox, or the Moxim. I think we can cut a couple creatures here. We can cut this Acidic Slime and the Jade White Ranger. This is going to create tokens for Great Hook Behemoth. I think Garrett can go here. So the idea of building these kind of decks, I don't think I mentioned that in the other Vintage Cube video. Normally what you want to go for is 16 or 17 lands and 23 or 24 cards, non-land cards. And in Vintage Cube, you get these Moxen, and usually you count them as lands, especially if you get, you know, the one that's in your main color. That's another thing I forgot about. You're timed on deck building in this Elimination Cube. in the Vintage Cube and in the League, you're not timed. Once you finish the draft, you can do whatever you want. You can take forever to finish your deck. So that's a little bit more of a pressure, high pressure situation. Scavenging Ooze can probably go for right now. Wall of Roots might be able to go too. It's not really proactive in me getting a lot of mana. It gets one extra. Yes, it does ramp, but it's not proactive in the idea that it can tap for mana and, you know, get Behemoth out there and get a bunch of damage going and, you know, be able to attack with it. So Awakening Zone and my Skull Clamp combo hopefully will work. Beast Within, maybe not very necessary. So we're already down to 23, including we got 26 and then the three Machin. And I feel like we could just add one more card because we have, you know, let's see, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. I mean, 8. I still count the Frey Lease as a mana producing card. So I mean, we got 8 mana producing cards on top of the Moxen. So I feel like we could at least add, you know, Wall of Roots, maybe Scavenging Ooze to gain a little bit of life main deck. We don't have really any other way to gain life. As I'm checking here, I don't see any. So I feel like Scavenging Ooze could be the play. Otherwise, we could bring in Acidic Slime if we see anything annoying like a land that's, you know, taking us over. Trigon Predator, I could put that in instead. The Ooze seems to fit the curve a little bit better. And again, if we see any kind of, you know, artifact or enchantment that's pesky that we want to deal with, we can bring in the Predator. So that's what I'm okay with. Did get Green Sun Zenith too. That's very strong. Got a little bit of interaction with enchantments and artifacts. Just those two, as far as I'm aware. Yeah. And this does deal with stuff too. I mean, of course, it's Karn. And this, of course, interacts with stuff too. But once you cast this, I mean, you have revealed yourself as a total degenerate. Got a considerable amount of dorks. Now, I think in this deck, now, this card is going to be used in a completely different way than it normally is. In Scapeshift and other constructed decks that use it in Modern and have used it in the past in Standard, I guess in Legacy. I don't know what it's used in Legacy or Vintage. I'm going to do my best not to sacrifice it and not to look for a basic land and put it on the battlefield tapped. Now, I understand it is a rampant growth with a 1/1 body attached to it, but ideally in this kind of deck, you get almost all of these. If I was in the League right now, I would have gotten probably 4 more 1-drop green creatures that produce mana. You know, I probably would have gotten the Avacian's Pilgrim and Birds of Paradise and, you know, some of the other ones like Noble Hierarch or something like that. I don't know exactly how many are in the cube, but I probably would have gotten all but maybe 1 or 2 of them. That's what's really fun about this cube. So we're going to go ahead and add the lands because it seems like most people might be ready to go. I put in the Sword of Body of Mind instead of the Sword of Feast and Famine. I feel like, you know, milling 10 cards from the top of their library and creating my own 2/2 wolf token for the Craterhoof to make giant later down the road is a little more efficient than having them draw a card or discard a card, I mean, and untap all of my lands. Now, if we do see, you know, black instead of blue or something like that, you know, we might be able to swap it out or figure a way to get it in there. You know, if we find that I have a lot of creatures and, you know, need the sword to work, I'll play both of them. I think I'm ready to go. Wow, this is a 13 forest deck. And then I've got the 3 Moxen. But then I've got all kinds of ramp, in its place. So this is a pretty ballsy deck to be playing. Now it is one of the archetypes, of course. You know, I'm not saying that it's innovative by any means, but it's a very ambitious deck. A lot of players would probably play 15 lands in their deck still, even though they have the 3 Moxen. I mean, but it's kind of split. You know, I mean, I would say it's probably 60% of players would probably play more basics or just more lands in general. And I'd say 40% would argue, no, you got 3 pieces of power, and the pieces of power are all Moxen, and one of them is in your color. So you might as well just cut it down and create, you know, treat them as basic lands that you can play, you know, on your turn. So hopefully we get, you know, one of them each game that we play. Looks like we're being matched up so far. Everybody was ready to go and pretty much finished within, I think, like another 2 minutes left or so in the deck building time. So that's good. So I think you might see a little bit different type of player in this. I'm not saying necessarily it's a better player, but it could be a faster player. A player that wants to get this over with, you know, even faster. And some people use that to their advantage. You know, they don't rush you, you know, in chat or anything like that, but they move very quickly. And sometimes, especially in person, it can be very intimidating. Pretty ideal play there. Island Soul Ring Dimir Signet. Okay, so they have a bunch of mana. I don't have anything to play. But next turn I do. I have a bunch of stuff to play next turn. Wow, so they're going to have 5 mana on this turn right here. And they're going to use it all. It's like Scarab God, maybe? Okay. Tameo. The Planeswalker. So it's going to tap down my creature, probably. Yep. Creature does not untap during the turn. That is rough. So I'm going to do my best here. I'm going to destroy their Soul Ring with the Reclamation Sage. In this type of cube, you need to have interaction with artifacts and enchantments in the main deck, at least 1 or 2 all the time. Every deck that you play, doesn't matter what it is, because there are players that are just going to have this every time. Turn 1, he had 2 artifacts out. It's absurd. Vintage Cube is amazing in that sense. Now, my plan is probably to use this Song of the Dryads, this commander card, and I'm going to turn their Planeswalker into a basic forest. Otherwise, I might play the Ancient Stirrings and see if I can get some kind of colorless card, but I have no expectations. So, Coercive Portal. And other artifacts. Okay. So I guess they forgot to use Tameo there. That's kind of peculiar. Play Rishkar. I'm going to give Rishkar and the Rexage counters. They all tap for green now. I tap for 3, I'm going to make their Planeswalker turn into a forest. punish them for forgetting to use their planeswalker. Now, they can use this portal here and pick, Will of the Council. They can pick Carnage. If they ever pick Carnage, I mean, I can still pick Homage and they'll still draw a card. So it's really up to me whether or not I want to destroy all non-land permanents. So they're going to play the new Jace, the creature that turns into a planeswalker eventually. Mox Pearl, how you doing? So we got 4, 5, 7, 8, 9. We are very close to casting this Ulamog. Did we get a land off of Ancient Stirrings? That'd be great. This is kind of cool. I'll really take anything off of this at this point. This is super tempting. I mean, I could take this. I could take the Karn here, actually. I think I'll take the Karn. I could have been really greedy and taken the land, but I can actually cast this Karn right now. And I'm just going to target them and their hand. They're going to untap their Assault Monolith. I'm going to bring 3 at them. I mean, you know, Karn will be wide open, yes. But I'm okay with that. Carnage? Well, I'm going to pick Homage. So, opponent has picked Carnage. They want to destroy all non-land permanents. They are telling us, hey, you're getting a little out of control there. So next turn, if we just draw a land or a Mox, we can just cast Ulamog straight up. And, I mean, this game will be all but finished. But they might have Detention Sphere or something here. I mean, I can't get too cocky. Because Vintage Cube is literally the most unpredictable monster there is. And this is, you know, a step up from that because you're in the Elimination queue. This is a pretty big deal as far as Magic Online goes, you know. So they're using the Jace. They only have 2 cards in their graveyard. It's not going to flip into a Planeswalker unless they have some kind of crazy, you know, card that puts a bunch of stuff in their graveyard real quickly. But it's already triggered anyway. This turn has checked it anyway, so it's not going to flip this turn. At least. So, Ravages of War. Destroy all lands. Okay. It seems like I'm in a little bit better position than they are. I'm a little bit confused by this. So they have Tangle Wire. Interesting. Okay. So they're going to try and hold us off for a couple turns, I guess. So this will tap down my whole field. But I still have a Karn. So I'm relatively confused about all this. I mean, I could exile it, you know, this turn, and they'd be unaffected by it, you know, and that's fine. Actually, that doesn't bother me very much at all. So they're still picking Carnage. I'm still picking Homage. They can draw a card all they want. At least in my eyes. They just destroyed all lands. To me, that was not a very smart play, but hey, can't stop you. Especially when my three creatures tap for mana. So Kozlik just hit the graveyard. That was the original Kozlik, so that shuffles their entire graveyard back into their library. Tapping a bunch of mana, and now Jace is flipped. Wow, I must have missed that part. Wasn't paying attention. Okay, Warren Power Stone, old card from Urza's Saga. Comes in tap, taps for two mana. Very good wrap card. Nothing wrong with it. So, it says up to one target creature gets minus two, minus zero until end of turn. Not sure which one he picked. Looks like he picked the Rishgar to get minus two, minus zero until end of turn. That's fine. We're going to play Awakening Zone. Awakening Zone. And we're going to make them exile a card out of their hand. They only have one in their hand anyway, so Upheaval was in their hand. Okay, then. They're playing a pretty crazy deck. So they're playing a deck where... Let's see if I can pull up Upheaval. I mean, I know a lot of players here that are, if they're watching this, they know the deck that the opponent's playing. But for people that are unaware, this is a card from Odyssey, pretty old, from like, what, 2001 or so. This card returns all permanents to their owner's hand. So what they do is they have a lot of these artifact mana cards, and they just have, they can just get a bunch of stuff out. They tap all their mana, say they'll have like 10 or 12 mana. They'll use six of it to use Upheaval, return everything to everybody's hand, play their land for the turn, and then they'll have seven mana available. They'll play, you know, cards that get them way, way ahead, and they'll just win that way. So, I mean, that's in and of itself, that's an archetype. Vintage Cube. Couldn't think of it. So, get a token out. And what do we draw? And we get a dork. We got a dork. Really, I'm high enough with Karn. I can just pop this Jace right here and, you know, not even think twice about it. Drop this here elf. Start attacking our opponent. So it looks like next turn, unless they're playing like Settle the Wreckage right now. Okay. I was a little scared there. I think Settle the Wreckage is one of those new cards that's in the queue. That's a very scary card. So our opponent keeps picking Carnage. They obviously think that we're going to slip up and pick Carnage also and destroy all non-land permanents. I think that would really screw our opponent over too, but it would screw us over way beyond them. We would have a forest. They would have two plains. And we would have nothing in our hand. We'd have a 10-drop card. Now, once we cast Ulamog, I might actually pick Carnage. Because, what is it? Does it say destroy or exile? Yeah, it says destroy all non-land permanents. Destroy doesn't destroy indestructible cards. So, our opponent does that. I don't know. That's too risky because, you know, they got two cards in their hand. They could just have, like, a Swords to Paradise, you know, Swords to Paradise, Swords to Plowshares. Okay, so drawing three cards. That's pretty good. That's the minus ability on Tamiyo. Pretty rarely used. But I think, pretty necessary in this instance. So Soul Ring comes into play. Porcelain Legionnaire for the play here. Okay. That's always good. Pretty sure we're just going to cast this Ulamog and try to win here. We could just destroy the Coercive Portal and the Tamiyo, maybe. That's 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10. Umag is in play. They are hurting. We're going to use Karn to attack their hand because they do have two cards in their hand now. Cut their hand in half. Now maybe I should have kept Coercive Portal and, you know, messed with them a little bit, but like I said, it's just too much of a risk. So they're playing the original Kozlik. This is by far the worst of the original three. It draws you four cards. Still a great card. But it's just by far the worst of the three. I used it in Standard in a Mono Green Elves deck. That was a lot of fun. Gosh, that was several years ago now. Upwards of about 6-7 years ago now. Okay, get the token out from Awakening Zone. I'm going to continue to attack their hand. And since Ulamog is indestructible, we will just attack with it and make them lose 20 cards, and they just lose the game next turn. Regardless of whether or not they can deal with the Ulamog right now. Because they can't draw a card. It is over. Ding, 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 ding. Game two. All right. I mean, that went well. Can't really fight that. That was, that was pretty strong. I still think most of the theories I mentioned during the draft are still, you know, relevant. I still think Copter is good. You know, got so many of these one-drop creatures and two-drop 1/1s and 2/2s and stuff. Just a bunch of little guys. And, you know, you can just jam them in that little helicopter thing right there and ship them off to wherever they need to do three damage, right? Yeah, sure. That makes sense. All right. I mean, I don't see anything really to take out. I mean, they're, let's see. Did we see a lot of artifacts? And yeah, we did see a lot of artifacts. Not so many enchantments, but a lot of artifacts. So I feel like Trigon Predator might be pretty good to bring in. Smuggler's Copter, I'm still going to keep that in there. It's something like maybe Rishgar. I might want to move it out, or the Master of the Wild Hunt. I think I can move that out, and I can move Rishgar. And we'll bring in Trigon Predator and Acidic Slime. I think Acidic Slime is really strong here. And this is essentially all of our artifact interaction. I mean, this is pretty good. And they did have several planeswalkers. I did see what at least two. But I don't want to stray too much from what worked, you know? Like this, the 40 that I had just a second ago worked. So I don't want to change too many cards. However, you know, if they do get the same kind of hand, and since they're going first, they could get that Armageddon flowing, you know, a lot faster and get, you know, Armageddon or Upheaval going a lot easier. So that's something to watch out for. But this looks this looks pretty strong, regardless of Armageddon. So they looked like they just snap kept that. I mean, I joined and they were already ready. So Mishra's Workshop on turn one. All right. Salt Monolith. That'll explain a lot of things. So turn one, we're going to play Moxborough and that. And we'll just play a Smuggler's Copter on turn one, actually. I think that's the better play, because then I can just play this little guy here and steal crew. Okay, so they have a pretty fast hand so far. Got a lot of artifact mana. I'm just going to go ahead and use Reclamation Sage, because I can right now. And I'm going to use it to crew. Hopefully this works. Draw a card, so I got a land there. That's pretty strong. I could drop the dork here. Don't necessarily need it. Don't necessarily need the land either. So I'm gonna go discard the land. Song of the Dryads on second thought might have been a little bit better to discard, because in this current game state, especially since it looks like, well, no, I guess they didn't miss a land drop technically. Okay, so that sucks. They copied my Reclamation Sage and destroyed my Smuggler's Copter. No. All right. Well, the theory worked the one time. Drew a forest still. We'll play the elf. And a scavenging ooze. And I guess we'll see. I guess Reclamation Sage trade here. I essentially did that just to be able to beef up Scavenging Ooze later on and attack, you know, for a little bit more damage. This turn, however, I think I'm going to destroy this Worn Power Stone with the Acidic Slime. I'm not sure what they have. They seem to be thinking pretty hard. They play nothing. I'm just going to Acidic Slime their Warm Power Stone. I probably could have. I forgot it destroyed the land. I could have killed the workshop. The Mishra's Workshop there. Might have been a slight misplay on my side there, but hey, what can you do? So, Joria, new card. Okay, let me read this. Whenever you cast a historic spell, draw a card. What is it? Historic spells are artifacts, legendaries, and sagas. Okay, alright. Sagas are those brand new enchantment looking kind of cards, the vertical looking cards. Kind of different looking, but hey, whatever. I think I'm going to turn Joria into a forest. Play a skull clam. And a land war elf. And attack for four. So next turn, once I have, since Skullclamp is out, I might just put it on one of my elves here and just draw two free cards. Depending on what the opponent does here. Ooh, something big. Wildfire! Woo! Woo! What a beating. Oh, man. Oh, man, that is brutal. Boy. Alright. 4 damage to each creature and sacrifice 4 lands. Alright. Well then. Man. I mean, if anybody wanted to watch this cube to see how fast tables can turn, there you go. Tables have been turned. I overextended. Way too much, though. I should not have played those last two creatures by any means. But still, that was, that certainly was different. So we have the, our combo out. We have Awakening Zone and Skull Clamp. So every turn, we're going to get a 0/1 spawn token. And every turn, we can equip Skull Clamp to it and draw two cards. So every turn, essentially, we can Ancestral Recall. So our opponent just did strip mine on our one land that we had left. A little bit of a jerk, but that's okay. Draw two cards. Not very good ones, but that's okay. Only have 21 cards left in the deck. So our opponent's also drawing off the top of their deck. They don't have anything in their hand. They have one card in their hand right now, only because of the beginning of their turn. I don't know, you know, what's left. I mean, I only beat them in the one game there. This game easily could go their way. Easily could go their way. Drawing two more cards off the token here. Playing an Elder. I could draw two more cards off of this, actually. Probably a little greedy, but that's okay. Go for it. So now we got Green Sun Zenith. Very strong card. We can Green Suns for 4 next turn, I believe. I did take a screenshot of my deck, so I'm not exactly sure what I have for 4. I didn't draft the Master, so I don't think I have... I did draft the Master, but it's not in the main deck, I don't think, actually, right? So, I don't think I have an actual 4 drop. I'm just going to have to do it for 3. Looks like they're playing Hangerbacked Walker for 4. That card's pretty unassuming a lot of times, but it can get out of control quickly. So, oh, whoops, I tapped out for 4. Oh well. It's not like I was going to do anything anyway. I can bring out Trigon Predator and go after their artifacts. I think that's probably the pick. Otherwise, it's go for Rafelos. You know? And I've already got, let's see, 5 mana, 6, 7 available. So, and then once the spawns keep coming out, I can have, you know, several spawns and behemoths and just crush them that way. So I think I'm going to get a little bit of a distraction out. I'm going to get Trigon Predator out. Now, I might have screwed up a little bit there because I could have, had left one untapped, put it on the token, and drawn two extra cards. That's what a professional player would have done. But, hey. So turn 12, this is going pretty long. But, I mean, like I said, they could win at any moment. They could get the other version of this card, which is, it does the exact same thing. It's just from the Portal 3 Kingdoms set, the Japanese-themed set. And it's Burning of some kind of town that I can't pronounce that starts with an X and an I-O, I think. I don't even want to insult people by trying to pronounce it. But it is, it's a 6-drop card that is very strong. And it does the same exact thing. Obviously y'all saw the power of Wildfire. So. I'm willing to take 4 damage. That's fine. I don't have a Planeswalker or anything. So. Go to 16. Looks like Upheaval is coming. Get to see the magnificent Upheaval. Alright, so he has cleared the board and has 3 mana left over. But now he has 6 because he can tap, for the workshop and make a bunch of artifact mana. So this is exactly what I was talking about. This is how far ahead they can get by playing all this stuff. Now, luckily, I can kind of catch up. Not really. I'll do my best. Because they had at least one more. I think they had another Mana Rock. Yeah, they have another Signet. And I don't know what else they had. I know they had the Hangerback Walker. So, I guess they put that out on 1. And just kind of grow it from there. And, they'll be considerably ahead of me. Now, what I'm still going to do is play a land and both the Moxes and the Trigon Predator. So, I'm going to do my best to keep up here. And the Trigon Predator will hopefully, if it stays in play, will hopefully regulate their artifacts. I do have 7 cards in my hand, don't I? Well, I guess a land is fine. Oh, I thought I had 8 cards in my hand. So, I had 9 cards in my hand. That's interesting. Freylise, not too interested in playing that. At least not this game. Game 3, very possible. So it looks like a bunch more mana going in. And something else sweet. Hangerback Walker for 3. Okay. Whew. That is not as bad as I thought it was going to be. Alright. So I think we're going to get our combo back online. And this Predator, this 2 damage that the Predator is doing is actually just as important as the artifacts that it's destroying. I don't want to destroy that Hangerback Walker quite yet because it creates a bunch of flying tokens that become blockers. So that's not the ideal play, at least right now. Now, I think I'm one of the few decks that this upheaval did not work against. You know, I think a lot of the other decks, like burn decks and white weenie decks and, you know, whatever else, you know, mono black decks or whatever else is being played, they will be severely affected by this deck. But hopefully we can beat them right here and nobody else will have to worry about it. So we have 3, 4, 5, technically, I guess, 6 mana here. I'm just going to play this Corsair Prufix. Sword of Body and Mind is on top of the deck. So next turn, I'll have 6 mana out and get spawn out. So I think I can legitimately draw these two cards here and be fine. Got a little bit of protection with the Corsair here. See, the thing was is that I had 2 pieces of power and I had the Trigon Predator, so I had the on color box to cast the Trigon Predator the same turn after they cast the upheaval. So I just had like the perfect card, both like a combination of cards to fight this upheaval. Especially because they had a bunch of artifact mana to get ahead. It's just like when you're playing in Legacy, if you play against a deck called Stasis, I think there's that green card, the Scrib Ranger. Scrib Ranger reads, if you actually read Scrib Ranger and translate it into, you know, layman terms for English, it says, screw target stasis deck, colon, screw target stasis deck. Both parts of the activated ability screw over stasis. It is absurd. So we're getting a life here. Might just go nuts. I mean, let's see. We got 4, 5, 6, 7 mana. Okay. So I can't quite cast Crater Hoof and really go nuts like I was thinking. But I'm just going to cast Karn. Get rid of their Hangerback Walker. Because this way it gets exiled. And that's the end of the match. So, this way, like I was talking about with the riskier playing in the Vintage Cube elimination, single elimination, I've gotten my money back already. I've gotten my play points back already, just with one match win. In the other version of Vintage Cube, where you're playing the matches, you know, in your leisure, you have to go 2-1 to get your 100 play points back. So, you know, granted, it's, you know, a little higher risk, a little higher reward. So if I win the next matchup, which let's see, oh, it's already starting. Okay, so that's good. If I win the next matchup, I can get 160 play points. If I lose this next matchup, then I still only get the 100 points, you know, that I just acquired. So that's fine. But if I can win both this matchup and the next matchup, if I win the whole tournament, essentially this 8-person tournament, I can get 220 play points, and I think, let's see, what is it called? What is it? Magic Online Championship Series Qualifier Point. You know, I've got several of those. I've probably got 8 or 9 of them right now. I'm not really sure. Eventually, hopefully they'll do something, but I've heard, you know, I've seen things where you need something absurd, like 35 of them. I just don't have the ability to get 35 of them in a certain, you know, time period. I think it's per quarter or per half year or something like that. Maybe it's all year this year. They seem to change their reward systems for the championship series every year. I can never really keep up with it because they have all kinds of stuff online on Magic Online. They got Pro Tour qualifiers, regional qualifiers. Then they got the challenges every week with the different formats, which is great. I'm not complaining. You know, there's so many options for us. It's just very difficult to keep up with unless you're just completely immersed in the game. All right, so we're in match two. We've got a pretty decent hand. Gonna go for it. Ooh, got a Mox Emerald there. That's pretty good. Helps us drop two of their dorks. And on turn two, we're going to have four, possibly five. Yeah, we got five lands on turn two. Potentially. Considering they don't have, you know, Pyroblasm or something. Love to draw Skull Clamp right now. Ooh, boy. That was fun, just drawing two cards every turn. Just casting a Ancestral Recall and a Mono Green deck every turn. Alright, well there's Master of the Wild Hunt. That's pretty good. I guess we sideboarded that out last match, so we didn't see that at all in the second game. And I could have gotten it in the Green Sun Zenith, so I definitely sideboarded it out. Well, we're pretty far ahead here. Turn two, Master of the Wild Hunt is difficult to deal with. Toxic Deluge would get rid of everything. Ashiok is one of those match-winning cards there. It can win all by itself. So they got Scavenging Ooze out of my deck and two other cards. But that Ashiok is not going to last long. It is certainly dying this turn. And we'll play Awakening Zone. Only thing we need now is Craterhoof. I mean, really. You know, once we get some more... Get some more of these. We get drop both of these out. I mean, well. Damnation changes a lot of plans. Oh, well. I'll play the Elder first. And like I said, in this kind of deck, we're going to try and keep the Elder out. So I'm not too worried about putting a counter on him. We're drawing from the top of the deck now. 15 cards in the deck. Murderous Cut, eh? Well, they've been murdered. Can't do much about that. Oh, that's right. So it doesn't actually tap for green anymore. It just has a counter on it. As long as Rishgar is out, they are able to tap for green. But not anymore. Craterhoof. Oh. Alright, well, hopefully next turn we get Craterhoof, because we can totally win with Craterhoof. Considering there's no counterspell or, you know, crazy removal or whatever. Oh. Didn't even notice that they had a land. A man land to attack with, or block with, I mean. Didn't even notice that. Craterhoof. That Actually, that's pretty good. So we can go 1 and 5, 6. Actually, I think we can win right here, considering they don't have a counter spell. Go find target Craterhoof Behemoth. And that makes all our guys incredibly large. They don't have 3 blue mana for Cryptic Command, so I believe that's the end of that one. Buddy, buddy, buddy. That's all, folks. Okay, so that was a lot of fun. I love Vintage Cube. This is so great. Let's see. It seems like I'm playing against some kind of 4-color control, just good cards kind of deck, which is very easy to draft. You can, in this Vintage Cube, regardless of, you know, single elimination or doing the league, you can get lost in the draft. You can end up, you know, with 3 different plans and all kinds of different places. I can't tell you how many decks where I have just thought that it was going to be epic, and I went 0-3, and how many decks that I was just like, seems okay, and I didn't even drop a game, much less, you know, more than 5 life. So, didn't really see much other than their Planeswalker that was threatening. Played a lot of spells that targeted my stuff, and I don't have anything like Heroic Intervention or anything that gives them hexproof, so there's really nothing I can do to prevent, you know, the mass destruction, like the Damnation and all that kind of stuff. The only thing I can do is keep it in mind, and you know, do my best not to overextend. So keeping that in mind, the Sword and Body of Mind will actually help that specific battle plan, because I'll be getting 1 or 2 creatures out at a time. Can just put the sword on it and hopefully do maximum damage. We're going to take this one land hand because it's got 2 one-drop dorks. And it draws a forest. That's always a good thing. So we're going to be able to get a turn 2 Courser of Crucifix out, hopefully. Definitely at least a 4-color deck here that we're dealing with. Got Awakening Zone on top of our deck. Foil lands on top. Whoop. They're doing something during our draw step, or our upkeep, actually. Looks like they're going to tap down probably the Courser or something else. Oh, one of our forests. Okay, that's fine. That's interesting. Now, this is a deck where they could have, you know, Splinter Twin or Kiki Jiki very easily and just win. So that is certainly something to think about. Yep, so that's the end of that one, folks. They make a combo. They make combos. Okay, so Splinter Twin. Looks like we're going to have to bring in all kinds of our interaction again. Trigon Predator is not going to help too much in this situation, but it might. So, I mean, I'm going to probably do all hands on deck kind of situation. there isn't really much of anything I can do to interact with the blue creature or with the you know, the first card that they played. Well then, not expecting to have them just get exactly what they needed, but, you know, it's Vintage Cube, so I cannot complain very much. I think we've got enough interaction here. We've got, let's see, got Song of the Dryads, but that can't be played at instant speed, obviously. This, I can't bring it in at instant speed either. Beast Within, I can use, you know, but I believe they actually have priority. So once I, you know, target it, they can just, you know, use it infinitely and beat me that way. I don't really have any way to prevent all combat damage or hold them off that in any sense. I don't have any way to do damage to them equal to the number of creatures they have. This is definitely difficult. But also, this is, I need to keep in mind, I cannot just be running scared of this combo. You know, sure, okay, if they get it again, fine, whatever. This is one reason why, you know, Splinter Twin is banned in Modern. You know, it even makes for terrible games in Vintage Cube. And if you start making people in Vintage Cube upset, you're playing a pretty degenerative combo. I can't turn this down. Turn one, Raphelos. Ancestral Vision from the opponent. Okay. Ancient Stirrings. That is a Karn. So next turn we'll have 2, 3. Oh, we'll have Karn mana next turn. Jeez, we're going to have Ulamog next turn? And next? No, we won't have Ulamog mana. But we will have Karn mana for sure. It's going to be like Tron versus Splinter Twin right here. Going to play my third Tron land. Going to go turn 3 Karn. Going to make you exile a card from your hand. This is absurd. It's terrible that this is pretty much what Modern is like. Okay. Keep exiling stuff from their hand. I destroy their artifact. And their ooze. Or my ooze. I'm gonna sick my ooze all over them, actually. This scavenging ooze is gonna be sicked all over them. I don't know, it looks like just a giant peach to me. I feel like James needs to be somewhere around there picking that damn thing. Maybe it's a huge pumpkin. I don't know. It's kind of weird looking, though. Damnation again! Damn! Nation. So we're just going to keep exiling cards from their hand, because it seems like that's the best way to do it. Ancestral Vision goes off, blah blah blah, they draw 3 more cards. They have five cards in their hand. Okay, cool. Phyrexian Revoker. That sucks. Five, six, seven mana already. Almost can cast a Crater Hope Behemoth here. Oh no! How did they get all the cards they needed? Did they get the Splinter Twin? Oh, that's ridiculous. Oh man. Well, that's disappointing. Okay, screw it. They played better than we did. They got better cards than we did. I don't know. Whatever it is. Thanks for joining me, folks. You know, this has been a super fun video. I just wanted to show you all the difference between Vintage Cube in the league and Vintage Cube in single elimination. It does change the psychology of the draft, especially. Doesn't really change much afterward, except for the wait time, you know. But, you know, I mean, it does kind of make a little bit more for high pace, you know, high octane games when you got more on the line. And the cool thing is that you don't have more to lose on the line. You know, it's the same entry fee for both options. So, you know, you both have just 100 points in it, and 160 points were on the line. So, you know, they got 160 points from us. Okay, fine. I still got 100 that, you know, and broke even. That's gambling for you. Had what I needed to win. Just needed one more, and necessarily, you know, wasn't necessarily going to win there, but was gonna do pretty well. That Phyrexian Revoker really got him, really changed the game, and the Damnation. I mean, they drew Damnation and held on to it, you know, as far as they needed to. Okay, well, I'm going to wrap it up. Had a great time with this deck. Thank you very much for joining me, folks. I will see y'all next time.